2001, September 18th, he put my father and other people, they're called the G15, in prison, and we haven't heard from them since. We had a big house, so it was always full of people and music and food.
It became very strange at home because nobody wasn't talking about it. The adults didn't want us to know much, or didn't want me to know much or worry me. So they always kept saying, oh, he's traveling, oh, he's working, he won't be around. And then eventually is when we heard, okay, dad is not coming home because he's been detained by the police. But we got lucky because he was caught, they apprehended him right outside our house. When for others, I think they were dragged out of their houses when their kids witnessed everything. During the war, my dad was the head of the spy division. And then after that, he became Minister of Foreign Affairs. And then after that, he was downgraded to Minister of Fisheries. Him and other ministers and other journalists wrote an open letter to the president telling him and expressing their concerns for the country, where this was going. Of course, the president didn't take it well. So in 2001, September 18th, he put my father and other people, they're called the G15, in prison, and we haven't heard from them since. Usually, when my dad came home, we spent a lot of time together, and I refused to let him go out of my sight. So when he fell asleep, I tied my leg to his in the morning, and when he woke up, he tugged my foot, so I woke up, and I'm like, where are you going? He's like, I'll be back, I'm just going for my regular jog. And I haven't seen him since, so. Usually he'll get up in the morning and he'll be out for the rest of the day, or I'm used to him when he worked as excuse me. When he worked as Mr. Fisheries, he would go to Massawa and be gone for a week, and then we'd go over for the weekends. So we had him only for 2-3 days. And when he came to the city, it was fun having him around. Everybody was at the house. And I didn't want him to leave again. So I thought I outsmarted him by tying my foot to his when he was sleeping. So in December 11th, I think it was, in 2003, she got on a plane here, and we were waiting for her with flowers at the airport, and we waited for hours, and we thought she just missed her plane. So we went back, called here in the US, and they're like, no, we got her on the plane. So it turns out when she got off the plane, they took her. The Eritrean military took her, the police took her, and we haven't seen her since. They've never seen a courtroom. We've never seen them, so.
No trial, no conviction, no date, no crime. I didn't realize what was happening until we got on the bus to Tesene. It was a really long bus ride, and it was just me and my grandma for a little bit. And that's when it kind of hit that we, emotions. It hit that we weren't going back home.
For 3 months, we were held in Naval Base. It's a ground zero, I think it's called, area where everything was everybody, they left the entire buildings to, no one was there, so they used the buildings as prison cells. We stayed there for 3 months and nobody knew where we were. So most of the families that were with us were kind of mourning for their children already. And then after 3 months, we were sent to Gedem, which is another prison in Massawa, much bigger, with much more inmates. We stayed there for 3 months, and then we were sent to another prison in Me'tir, which is further away in the middle of the desert, with even less food and harsher conditions. The food was never enough. Every morning we were counted to go. Well, we were put in a line, counted, and taken somewhere a little bit further away to do our business. But even before we were done, they would pass by. The guards would pass by hitting us to let us know that we were done, even though we weren't. So we'd be all smudged and whatnot. And go back in line and laugh it out. We just laughed it out. So they just took us from farm to farm to work the fields. We would work from morning till sunset, again with little food. And if we tried to steal some of the tomatoes, we also got punished for it. But they were good, they were worth it. So this has been 2 years then since I have seen my family or heard of them. I pleaded with my general, the leader of my unit, and he sent me off with a warning that he'd drag me back by the hair if I didn't come back in 2 weeks. I went home and stayed for a month. A couple of times they called my house to check that I was still there. It was nerve-wracking. I felt like a failure for coming back. So, on May 6th, after my dad's birthday, I escaped again. I think before, I was naive enough to hope that my parents would be out and they'd be fine. No. I just hope they're mentally sane. Or at least functional enough that they can go through it or move past it. Of course, I wish to go back home, which is why I'm studying clinical psychology for that. We don't believe in it back home. We don't talk about depression. We don't talk about PTSD. I wish to see my parents in my lifetime.